And I will welcome everyone again to the In Her Own Right Symposium. We trust that those of you who attended the first day's sessions found them engaging and educational, and we look forward to having you with us tomorrow. I'm Marjorie Spy, Director of Special Collections at Temple University Libraries, and a member of the project and symposium team for In Her Own Right. And it's my privilege to introduce tonight's keynote speaker. But first, some thanks and some housekeeping notes. Again, thanks to the Bates Center for the Study of the History of Nursing at the University of Pennsylvania, Bryn Mawr College Libraries, Drexel University College of Medicine Legacy Center, Drexel University Lenfest Center for Cultural Partnerships, the Philadelphia Area Consortium for Special Collections Libraries, and Temple University Libraries for their generous support of the keynote tonight. And we're also grateful to the Friends Historical Association for funding the live closed captioning. We ask that all participants follow the PAC School Code of Conduct located at pacschool.org. And since some of you may be joining us for the first time, here's some Zoom info. My apologies to those of you who've heard this many times before today. During this session, we've disabled chat for attendees and are using it only as a way to send messages to all of you. So if you have questions for the speaker, or if you're experiencing technical issues and would like our assistance, please submit them through the Q&A option, which should be visible to you at the bottom of your Zoom screen. You're welcome to post your questions for the speaker at any time, but we'll save all of them for the Q&A period at the end of the session. We are indeed so pleased to have Professor Martha S. Jones with us tonight. She's the Society of Black Alumni Presidential Professor, Professor of History, and a professor at the SNF Agora Institute at the Johns Hopkins University. A legal and cultural historian whose work examines how Black Americans have shaped the story of American democracy, her most recent book, Vanguard, How Black Women Broke Barriers, Won the Vote, and Insisted on Equality for All, published last year, was selected as one of Time's 100 must-read books for 2020. I encourage you to read her complete biography on the symposium website. We are grateful to have her join us to reflect on women, issues of race and class, suffrage, and primary sources. Martha, thanks for being with us.
Well, thank you so much for having me with you. I'm so glad this day is here. I feel like we first talked about this a very long time ago, and it's really an honor to be with you all and to be part of these conversations. I'm especially grateful for the chance to think frankly, some new ways about the work that I've most recently done on Vanguard. So I can't imagine a better opportunity than this gathering. And I thank you to everybody associated with In Her Own Right for including me in the conversation. I've been dying to talk about archives. And I want to start by saying a little bit about Vanguard, just a very little bit. It is an effort to look across 200 years of African-American women's political history with a focus on the long struggle for voting rights, a story that takes us from the first decades of the 19th century all the way through 2020. And so it is a political history, but from the beginning, it was a book intended to make an argument. It had a claim. It intended to intervene in gently, subtly, but importantly, I hope, in how we think about African-American women's political history in the archive. Especially, it turned out to be an opportunity for me to reflect upon the relationship of Black women themselves to the archive that we have inherited that we have shepherded and that we rely upon as we write our histories. And I am someone who came to this field very much nearly 20 years ago, if you will, under the shroud of a kind of what today I think of as a kind of myth about Black women and the archive. I am one who has sat at the desk across from distinguished historians, from seasoned archivists, and ordinary people at the dinner table who told me that my aspirations, my goals, my interest in African American women's political history was a sort of folly, that Black women had left us too little, too slim a record. This started when I was a doctoral student and I was sketching out the terms of a dissertation, and I still sometimes encounter it today. And this book, Vanguard, very much aimed to wrestle with and to an important degree dispel that myth. And it turned out to be the kind of project in which, rather than working at odds with folks, I found myself linking arms with librarians and archivists, curators, building upon the important work that has been done and continues to be done around preserving and cataloging and increasingly the digitization of the materials that undergird a book like Vanguard. Now, students don't love it when I say this, but you've got to read the endnotes to appreciate that argument. This is not the sort of book that in the prose foregrounds these kinds of scholarly and professional interventions, but the endnotes are indeed an argument. And if for those who take the time and have the inclination to go through them, what they'll discover is that Black women are indeed there in the archival record. And more to the point, that they themselves left us traces, signs, yes, and even oftentimes full-throated testimony about their lives, about their ideas, about their political work. They speak for themselves very much in the pages of Vanguard. And this is something I wanted readers to take away from the book. So what I want to do with you today is to reflect on three sorts of women I encountered in Vanguard, and they stand in for many, many others. For this afternoon, I want to term them one subset of them, the deliberate. And these are women who, out of their own purposes, out of their own political projects, out of their own necessaries, become chroniclers and memoirists and correspondents. These deliberate women who pick up pen, put that pen to paper, who visit the printer, who have their thoughts set in type, very deliberately create a record that I and historians like me have returned to. We are indebted to those deliberate women. But they're not the only women we find in the archive, or we hope to find in the archive. There are also the reluctant African-American women who, out of the exigencies of their own times, self-consciously constrained, concealed, and even went so far as to destroy the evidence of their lives, their ideas, and their work. The reluctant are more elusive figures, and we'll talk some about how I encountered them in the archive. And the last group I'll call the self-conscious. And this is especially in this book project, women of the 20th century, women who I had less experience with as a historian when I started out in this project, the self-conscious, the women who know that we are coming, that their lives are of historical consequence, and that indeed librarians and curators and archivists, along with historians and other fellow travelers, will be coming back to the record that they are creating, constructing very self-consciously to try and interpret their lives and work. I think for me, the most challenging perhaps were the self-conscious. And so I'll end with that example. But let me begin with the deliberate. And here I want to hold up the example of the early 19th century AME church preacher, Jarena Lee. Jarena Lee, who spends her young life as a bound servant, as a now free woman, settles in the city of Philadelphia. And her life story is one about the quest for religious authority. And it figures importantly in opening Vanguard because Jarena Lee was someone who importantly began to craft a philosophy, a worldview, a vision for herself that became instructive and folded into Black women's political thinking going forward. Jarena Lee is someone I think of as really setting in place some of the essential building blocks of that theory at the end of the 20th century we call intersectionality. Lee is at work at the dawn of the 19th century, trying to think her way through the dilemma of racism and sexism as they come together in her life and in her aspirations to be a fully licensed preacher in the AME church. And she is deliberate. In the 1930s, Jarena Lee, like many of these deliberate women, folds into her purpose, into her project, the demands of writing, of publishing, of circulating her ideas in print. In this, there is a process. In this, there is a means to a livelihood. And of course, for us in this, there is the ability then to go back and to understand her life better. And in the 1930s, Lee will take a break from what have been arduous but extraordinary years on the preaching circuit. Thousands of miles traveled, hundreds of speeches, sermons, and more delivered. She will take a break to pen a spiritual memoir. It is, for Lee, I think, not an effort to quite write herself into history, though it turns out to do that. For Lee, it is in first and foremost, the memoir itself is a spiritual journey, right? It is part of a longstanding religious tradition among Christians. It is on the page that Lee confesses not only her own ambition, but how she must struggle both with her inner self and with the world in order to realize this. And we return to this very deliberate memoir as a guide, in essence, to her vocation, to her struggles, and to those thousands of miles and hundreds of preaching moments that are so important for understanding her thinking. Because she leaves us this very deliberate text, we are able to then use other kinds of sources to fill out the story, whether those are now the extraordinary corpus that are digitized newspapers that are transforming in extraordinary ways the way we do our work, whether it is the minutes of church conferences, those pamphlets that the AME church so self-consciously produces to bring itself into being institutionally. What emerges from these materials is, yes, Jarena Lee as the struggling Christian preacher in an institution that imagines itself as evidenced through the life's work of men. But what also emerges is Jarena Lee as a thinker, as a shrewd analyst of her own status, as a woman, as a Black woman preacher at the dawn of the 19th century, as a shrewd analyst of her own condition, someone who, if she is to realize her own aspirations, if she is to realize the calling, which she understands to be one that comes directly from God, she must wrestle. She is indeed someone who begins to help us understand the long roots of intersectionality and inspires ultimately generations of Black church women to follow in her footsteps, be they those who aspire to preach themselves or those who aspire to organize, whether it is in conferences or missionary societies and more. Jarena Lee, by virtue of leaving this archive, becomes a touchstone for AME church women and helps me to situate her unexpectedly, I think, for many readers at the outset of a story that is ultimately about women in politics, a story that ultimately takes us all the way to someone like Georgia's leader, Stacey Abrams, in the 21st century. But Jarena Lee leaves us that artifact that opens the door to that story. I mentioned the reluctant as a second category or collection of women in this story. And for that story, I want to turn to another woman from Philadelphia, and that is Sarah Mapps Douglas. Sarah Mapps Douglas is among the reluctant, someone who ultimately looks to organize her archive such that she might have remained, if her wishes had been fully realized, remain wholly and forever below history's radar. Sarah Mapps Douglas aimed to avoid our scrutiny. She aspired to remain beyond the pages of the historical record. How do we know that? Because Sarah Mapps Douglas is among those women who, in her final will, directs her executor, her brother Robert, to destroy her papers, to disappear any evidence of her time as an educator, which she was, as an activist, which she certainly was, as a woman who spoke provocatively, controversially, and importantly about women's health and reproductive health. Sarah Mapps Douglas, in the end, decides that that should not be part of her legacy and her record. I'm indebted, as I often am, to a student who, in one semester some years ago, became fascinated by the figure of Sarah Mapps Douglas, had read her letters in The Liberator, had read about her in the writings of other historians, and headed to Philadelphia to recover what she could about her, and finds that will. And it's a will and a text that changes my thinking forever. But Sarah Mapps Douglas does not get the last word, and we'll want to think about that more carefully. Sarah Mapps Douglas, despite having, I think, successfully directed that her papers be destroyed, survives in the historical record. For example, in her correspondence with the Grimke sisters, which today are on deposit at the William Clements Library at the University of Michigan. She survives in the pages of friendship albums that are on deposit and digitized by the Library Company of Philadelphia and at Howard University. Here, Sarah Mapps Douglas, even as her will is strident, doesn't quite have the reach, right, to destroy every trace of her. My student had become fascinated by her correspondence in The Liberator and other newspapers, where she begins to chart out her vision for women's politics in early American Philadelphia. We discover Sarah Mapps Douglas as the strategist, as the organizer, as the shrewd interlocutor with men that she was. She is an essential facet in a chapter about the ways in which in early America, Black women are, yes, part of their own community politics, while they are part of religious communities like that of the Arch Street Meeting House in Philadelphia. Sarah Mapps Douglas is someone with intimate relations like those of the Grimke sisters. She is someone who leaves a mark and leaves us, I think, with an ethical question about how to regard women when we do discover them in the archives, despite their best efforts. Can we, should we tell their stories? And we'll come back to that question in a bit. The last figure I want to highlight here, I've dubbed a representative of the self-conscious, and that is Mary McLeod Bethune, a native of South Carolina, who settles in Daytona, Florida. Bethune is an educator, a suffragist, an organizer, an institution builder, and more across her long lifetime. But Bethune, I think, from very early on in her life, knows, and perhaps not only knows, desires that she be the subject of historical inquiry. Bethune, from very early on, understands that as she collects, as she saves, as she preserves her personal papers, along with the papers of the institutions like the National Association of Colored Women's Clubs and the National Council of Negro Women, the institutions that she builds, as she preserves those papers, she knows that we are coming. And she hopes, I think, that we will arrive at her archive and further write her into the annals of American history. Bethune is remembered for many things. She lives a life from 1875, Reconstruction, all the way to 1955 and the modern civil rights era, and passes through many chapters. And as a consequence, her papers are voluminous, they are wide ranging, they take us through many, many chapters that I tell in the book that is Vanguard. That is to say, they take us through many, many chapters of African-American women's politics from the early organizing of the NACW through the struggles over the 19th Amendment, through the difficult years of disenfranchisement after 1920, and on through not quite to the Voting Rights Act of 1965, but certainly on through the modern civil rights era. Speeches, correspondence, shards, published materials, keepsakes, and more. She gives us an irresistible powerful look. And the scale of the archive is such that you might be left to think that if you've gone through Mrs. Bethune's papers, you might not need to look anyplace else, that everything is there. And we'll come back to that, of course. It's a bit of a misunderstanding. So as we better understand the relationships to the archives, as we come back to these artifacts, to the stories they permit us to tell, not only for the stories they permit us to tell, but what we think about them in relationship to the women who produce them. I think we're forced, in the best sense, we are forced to also think about and better understand our relationships, both to the women who created them and to their archival materials, in what I think of as ethical terms. So let's return to them again. And the first you'll remember is Jarena Lee, The Deliberate. Lee's text is a spiritual memoir. She created it as a way of thinking through questions about faith, about God, about Satan, about her own calling. How does a Black woman know when she has been called to preach, if she has been genuinely called to preach? And Lee's purpose, to a very important degree, is that, is to memorialize, to witness, to confess her own journey, even as it is filled with moments of profound uncertainty, of profound self-doubt. And I have done something that I think Lee herself would not have anticipated and might not have countenanced, which is to say, I have taken that religious text and I have used it for secular understanding. I have used it to lay a foundation for thinking about how Black women come to politics, a realm that Lee never occupied and one she never aspired to. And my teacher on these things, early on, the great historian Judith Weisenfeld, long ago urged me that I was obliged to regard such a memoir first and foremost by the terms that Lee herself understood it. And I think I've tried to do that. But I think I'm also, in a sense, guilty of mining it, excising what I needed from it, from the whole, rendering it as a text that perhaps Lee herself might not have recognized and might not have countenanced. Douglas is the reluctant. And we'll never, I think, be able to say wholly and completely why it was that she directed her brother Robert, her executor, to destroy her documents. How did she come to do that? Why did she do that? And I'm left with a question about whether and the degree to which we defy her wishes when we reach here and reach there and begin to reassemble and archive those shards that were left elsewhere that she did not enjoy dominion over at the end of her life. I think we have to appreciate that she very well may have preferred that those letters to the Grimkes too be burned or shredded. She might have preferred that the pages in those friendship albums be cut out and tossed. Historian Darlene Clark Hine speaks to this very importantly when she explains to us how among Black women there is a culture of dissemblance, a culture that very deliberately worked to shield Black women's most intimate lives from public scrutiny, to shield their families, their children, their marital relations, their sexuality from public view and from the view of the historian. That Sarah Mapps Douglas was not alone when she, in her will, admonished her brother, and I think admonished us to take care and to keep private those parts of her life that would have put her at risk if they had come to the surface. And yet there she is in the pages of Vanguard. So I want to come back to Mrs. Bethune, finally. Mrs. Bethune, the self-conscious. Because in writing this book, I think there's no one whose archive, in my experience of her archive, there's no one who has left me with more reason to reflect and even to second guess myself. And here, she gives me a chance to say one more thing about Vanguard, which is that it was a book that was very much intended to, I think as many of us do, I wanted to replace myths and half-truths about Black women, about their political lives, about their political trajectories, about their political visions. I wanted to set aside myth and misunderstanding and replace it with, you know, good evidenced history. Now, I'm hardly alone in that project, and Vanguard is a book that stands on the shoulders of dozens upon dozens of Black women's historians who have done just that over many generations now. But we were coming on the anniversary of the 19th Amendment, a moment that threatened to trade too often in myth and to sacrifice history. I thought I was going to be the agent of dispelling myth, of putting to bed myth. And my story of Mrs. Bethune was no exception to that expectation. I thought that she deserved historical truth with a, you know, with a small t, but historical truth, as did all the women in this book, as did we as historians, as archivists, as librarians, as curators, as do readers. We all deserved historical truth. But when I, as I spent time in Mrs. Bethune's archive, as I reflected on the trouble I had in her archive, my reflection is that I'm not convinced that truth was what Mrs. Bethune wanted as her legacy at all. Mrs. Bethune was a politician. And in that sense, she needed to craft, she needed to tell, she needed to promote stories about herself, stories that we might call myths. She needed to foreground stories that defied, that deviated from, that embellished upon, and otherwise were at important distance from the difficult, gritty, complicated historical record that was the record of her life. One of the most often told stories about Mrs. Bethune is set on an election day eve, oftentimes set on election day eve in 1920, that auspicious year when the 19th Amendment is ratified. The story goes that Mrs. Bethune, who has been a valiant organizer, promoter, guide to Black women in Florida when it comes to casting their first votes in 1920. The story goes that Mrs. Bethune has won so much repute for her work that on election night eve in 1920, she is visited on the grounds of her girls' school there in Daytona. She is visited by members of the Ku Klux Klan. They appear on horseback. They are in full regalia. They are carrying torches. They march onto the grounds of her school threateningly. The story goes, oftentimes Mrs. Bethune stands out front defiant, her arms crossed, facing down the Ku Klux Klan. Some versions of the story have her faculty and her students who are hiding in darkened buildings in anticipation of the Klan, breaking into song, right, into religious song, in defiance of the Klan. Other versions have her faculty standing alongside her as sentinels, also facing down the Klan. And the story goes that after encountering Mrs. Bethune and maybe her faculty, the Klan turns around and leaves the grounds unscathed and unintimidated, because the next day Mrs. Bethune will get up and turn out to the polls and cast her ballot alongside the Black women of Daytona. It's a remarkable story. Remarkable for what it tells about Mrs. Bethune's character, about what it takes to be a Black woman with political ambition in 1920 in a state like Florida. It is a remarkable story about community, the ways in which Mrs. Bethune, her students, her faculty, and the Black community of Daytona hang together in the face of violence and intimidation that comes to them by way of the Klan's activism. It's a remarkable story. And if folks know little about Mrs. Bethune, it's the one story they'll tell you. But I was invited by Smithsonian Magazine to write this story about Mrs. Bethune as they were featuring Black women suffragists on their pages. And I began to, yes, work with Mrs. Bethune's archive, where versions of this story are told again and again. But I don't have to tell you what happens when you encounter version upon version of a story. They don't match up. So being the truth seeker that I am, I head to the newspapers. I head to other archives. I head even to other historians who were very generous in sharing their research process. And I cannot confirm many of the details of this story. What I can confirm, for example, is that it doesn't appear Mrs. Bethune was actually in Daytona on the eve of Election Day in 1920. She was out of town and didn't return until the next day. So what's happening here? What's happening, I think, is that I, the historian, with my truth-telling tools, instruments, the archive, I am confronted with and confronting the story that Mrs. Bethune crafted, that she changed over time, and that ultimately she successfully planted in many places, including, for example, on the pages of children's literature, but also on the pages of very good histories. And so here, I think I finished that article feeling very satisfied that I had, with my archival capacities, somehow defied the myth, right? Dispelled the myth, corrected the myth. And I think that the article is true to the historical record, as true as I could be in the moment that I finished it, at least. But my reflection is, of course, a reflection that only happens after the book is done and the article is done, is about Mrs. Bethune herself. And I had to ask myself over time why she had promoted, produced, permitted these myths to be reprinted, to be retold, to be published, to be promoted. And what I want to leave you with is this reflection about how Black women in politics, but not only Black women in politics, but certainly the women I've written about, needed stories, needed myths, needed untruths even, as their calling cards, as their weapons, and as their shields. Mrs. Bethune, like so many of the women in Vanguard, knew that we were coming, and knew that it was necessary for her to do that which she could to control, to frame, to preset the stories that we would tell. And she leaves those myths intact. And I think this is where I want to leave us with it, which is, I think, for me, an enduring, ever-present, and necessary reflection about our ethical relationship, yes, to the archive, but yes, to the women who create the archive. I can't say for sure that I've done Mrs. Bethune the justice that I might have, but I'm deeply grateful to her for posing the question so vividly for us. So with that, I think I'll end my formal remarks, and I'll hope that I think someone's going to rejoin me so that we can continue with questions and comments and discussions. And I want to say thank you to everybody behind the scenes and in front of the cameras for this symposium. It's really an extraordinary honor to be with you this evening.
Well, Martha, thank you so much for that really fascinating, intriguing talk. And I certainly have a question to start you off with. I spent some of my early archival career at Smith College listening to people like Carolyn Heilbrun and Jill Kirk Conway talk about women's autobiography and how they were, in fact, writing it to present a particular image to the reader. Do you have a sense of what models Mary McLeod Bethune was using, or do you think she's created her her presentation out of her desire to present something new?
Well, I think, you know, in many ways she is unprecedented, if I could put it that way. Right. Part of Bethune's story is about being born in South Carolina in 1875, the last of 11 children, the only one to attend school in the years as Reconstruction is being defeated, coming of age in Jim Crow, creating out of whole cloth. Right, her industrial school for girls that becomes today's Bethune-Cookman University. She really is writing a new chapter in American history in many ways. And I think my reflection is that in fact, she's teaching us how to tell that story, right? How to draw that arc and to make those connections. And it is a story like no other. Now, she's not alone. And we know that many of the women of her generation, Ida B. Wells, Mary Church Terrell, those are women who pen their own memoirs. Bethune drafts a memoir that's not published. And if I had a question for her, it would be about that. And whether, you know, from beyond, she regrets not having taken the matter more firmly in hand. And on the other hand, she cooperates with some very interesting writers who do memorialize her life. In my humble estimation, the two best memoirs and biographies of Mrs. Bethune are young adult biographies written by folks who actually visited with her, met her in Daytona later in life, met many of the folks who worked closely with her, and did the kind of you know, firsthand interviewing that permitted them to not only get beyond the myths, but to give extraordinary texture to the myths. But we'd have to ask ourselves, as I ask myself, what do you do with two wonderful young adult biographies that have no footnotes, remarkable quotes, colorful details that ring so true, but don't lend themselves to the kind of footnote that I have to write in a book like Vanguard? I hope someone will write that article, at least, because they're remarkable. And I think they probably are the best iterations, particularly of these critical stories that we have. So whether Mrs. Bethune thought it was a missed opportunity or something she wanted to leave open-ended, I can't say. But you're right to point out that her she and Black women like her are not alone, right, in this project of trying to very carefully curate the archive and steer us, if not steer us wrong, at least steer us in the histories that we write.
Speaking of footnotes, Sabrina Evans has a question and comment. I loved your comment about the argument that endnotes can make. Can you speak further about the archives you relied upon in your research, or perhaps your favorite find from the archives?
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much for that. I have to say that this work is really that far ranging. You know, Mary Church Terrell's papers are at the Library of Congress. They've been treated to a transcription project that makes them all the more accessible to readers. Sarah Mapp Douglas's letters are in manuscript at the Clements Library. Many of these published materials are part of collections like Documenting the American South. Today they are in Hathi Trust and places where we go to find digitized early published materials. One of the lessons that I always knew, but I think this book taught me in vivid terms, is what the digitized newspaper revolution has meant for our work. I write about a figure like Frances Ellen Watkins Harper, whose speeches, and to an important degree, her poetry and certainly her fiction have been published and published again in collections. The fine details of her time on the lecture circuit, for example, I think just couldn't be without, you know, an extraordinary and very specific effort, couldn't be recreated until I was able to benefit from the many, many digital collections, as you all know, some of them commercialized, like the ones published by Redex, others of them coming from the Library of Congress and beyond. I was able to recreate kind of day by day, city by city, right? Month, week by month, her travels, and to begin even to do some calculations about, you know, the miles she traveled and such. So there is so much that is new. I'm in part a legal historian, and I think that the legal archive has come into its own as a source, not only for legal historians, but for political historians, social historians, biographers, and more. And so many of the court cases that undergird some sections here had been known only through newspaper accounts. And now I could go back to testimony and see the full text of the legal archive in ways that I hadn't before. So when I say that I think this history is under our noses, I don't mean that to be blithe, but I do mean it to say that we have lived, as you all are the agents of, a revolution, right, that is making sure that my students, right, really have a quite a snappy retort when somebody says to them, you can't write this history, it doesn't exist, right? The sources aren't there. The question was, were there any special finds? It's hard to say because there are so many, but I will confess that I was someone who, and I guess you can hear it in my reflections about Mrs. Bethune, I had been ambivalent about memoirs, especially 20th century memoirs, which I took to be these self-conscious, highly crafted efforts to distract and dissuade me from what I really wanted to know. But I think I really benefited from, and I think the book benefits from taking those kinds of materials seriously. And yes, subjecting them to some scrutiny, but taking seriously even what are recollections years later, and taking seriously how women wanted to be remembered. Mary Church Terrell is a fascinating figure, yes, in her papers. I think she's fascinating in a different way in her memoir and the ways in which she wants to be remembered. And throughout this book, I had to go very deliberately to sources to recover a thread that was one of the hardest threads to write about. And that is the violence to which so many of the women in this book were subjected. This is true famously for Ida B. Wells, but it is true for almost everyone here. And those stories were not the first stories that women always told. They were not the ones that they foregrounded always. But once I understood women like Terrell, women like Bethune, Wells, and others telling those stories, I then could tune in and discover that it was a tragic rite of passage for a Black women in public life and in politics. Violence and the threat of violence, including sexual violence, was ever present in their lives. And that was one of the hardest of the realizations for me in this book, to not only know the fact of that, but to be able now to read the testimony and their own words and their own recounting of that those experiences is something that changed me, frankly, as a women's historian.
Thank you. Many of us got into this business because we love the detective work and the research and the tracking down of things, and rejoice when we find something. Is there a woman or two that you've bookmarked and hope to go back to and try to search out more information about them? Women that you weren't able to include because you couldn't in your time span find them? But
yeah, thank you for that. And the answer is absolutely. One of the wonderful things about writing this book when I did and how I did is that many of the women in the book are right now being treated to full book length new biographies. Fannie Lou Hamer, for example, has two biographies coming out very near on the horizon. Frances Ellen Watkins Harper, and on and on. So in some ways, this is a book very much written in community. And as we often work, I won't write it all. But anybody who's had a chance to look at Vanguard knows that this book begins with a few stories that I tell about women in my own family. And here, I became self-conscious as I was finishing this book that I actually didn't know their stories, that I come from African-American women, many of whom were in their own ways activists in their lifetimes. But I had never asked the question about how they fit into this saga about Black women's politics and voting rights in particular. So I did the thing I wasn't supposed to do, which is I took a detour. My editor, if he had known, would have just been unhappy, but I had to. And I had to use my historian's skills to do it because they were not here for me to, interview personally. And I had some success. I had some success. For example, I find my great-grandmother, Fannie Williams, in St. Louis in 1920, running a suffrage school in a Black YWCA, along with other women, as they are getting ready to breathe life for Black women into the 19th Amendment in that city. And they are successful. My own grandmother, I find in the 50s and 60s in her hometown of Greensboro, North Carolina, where she is part of the civil rights revolution and supporting young women in that city, students who are doing voting rights work, registering Black Americans, getting to them to the polls. So I had some luck. It was an affirmation about a long-held interest of mine and going back to their lives and telling them more fully. So today I'm at work. And excuse me if you heard that. That's me not knowing how to turn off my phone in all the midst of this. I apologize. But so I'm at work now on a family memoir that looks at their lives across many generations to understand my questions about the history of slavery and sexual violence and how Black women have told and retold and in some generations declined to tell that facet of their family histories. And I will use the women in my own family to tell that using our archives and our techniques to try and do justice to that story. So yes, as is so often true for us, right? One project leads to another. If I could just take a moment to say, the very first paper I wrote in graduate school was a very poorly executed attempt to tell a bit of family history. And my professor taught me the word hagiography because I had never used it before, which was to say I wasn't really ready for prime time. But I'll let people judge for themselves if in these opening pages of Vanguard, I've managed to use my family's history to some historically worthy effect. I hope so. And I continue to be deeply moved by that challenge. So as we say, stay tuned. Thank you for that.
Wonderful. Thank you. Elena P. asks, what myths do you hope to dispel or correct about the participation of Black women in the women's suffrage movement?
So I think one of the myths that enshrouds the story of the 19th Amendment, interestingly, well, there's the one that says, right, all women got the right to vote, or the 19th Amendment, you know, guaranteed to women the right to vote. And we know, I think, most of us certainly in this group know that that doesn't hold, right? That many American women cannot cast ballots in 1920 because of age, because of citizenship, because of mental competence. It was still true in 1920 that American women who married non-US citizens lost their citizenship and couldn't vote. And for Black women, of course, the hurdles of poll taxes and literacy tests, intimidation and violence, like in the story of Mrs. Bethune, means that not all women get the vote in 1920. But the other myth, I think, is that Black women don't get the vote and that Black women don't vote in 1920. And of course, the record tells us otherwise, that Black women are voting in places like California in 1911, 1913 in Illinois, 1917 in New York. Black women are already voting by the time, in many places, in important places, by the time we get to 1920. But it's also true, right, that Black women become mere equals. And that's not a matter of custom or only a function of violence and intimidation and illegitimate interventions, right? It is state law that keeps many, many Black women from the polls in 1920, because they can't overcome those hurdles that have already been keeping men from the polls for many decades. So this myth, right, which is, you know, as oftentimes myths are, right, they are broad swaths that simplify history. But I think we're due to be retired as we came into this 2020 anniversary year. So I hope we were somewhat successful. And of course, I'm not alone in that work at all. So many fellow travelers from Liette Gidlow to Kathleen Cahill to Allison Lang and Lisa Tetro, and I shouldn't even begun to name people, Brianna Royster. There's so many folks who really ensured that we had a robust and refreshingly new look at the question in 2020, that I think it's been a remarkably successful, it was a remarkably for all the strangeness, I think it was successful on this point, I hope.
Great, thanks. Lois Levine asks, can you talk about Vanguard as it fits in the trajectory of your own work? Did any of the insights you gained during this project cause you to rethink any elements of your previously published work?
Thank you. I wrote a book that was published in 2007 called All Bound Up Together, The Woman Question in African-American Public Culture, 1830 to 1900. That's a mouthful, isn't it? But I published that book. It was my first book, and it looked at 19th century African-American debates over women's rights. And I like to think it was a successful book. I think it still turns up on, you know, syllabi and on, you know, graduate student reading lists and things like this, still in print. That's, you know, it's kind of great after 13 years. But I was at a meeting, one of the big historical association meetings, maybe the Organization of American Historians, with my colleague Lisa Tatro and Laura Edwards. And I think we were supposed to kind of reflect about the state of women's history and maybe the suffrage anniversary. And as soon as I sat down, I realized I was vexed because there was an argument I had made in All Bound Up Together that people had not taken seriously enough by my lights. Now, maybe all authors feel like that, right? Some of you haven't taken me seriously enough. But it was this piece that we touched on, which is about how church women play a role in shaping what become Black women's secular politics, an essential, foundational, undeniable role in shaping ideas, strategies, tactics, personnel, and more. And I had argued that in All Bound Up Together, but rarely did people speak to me of that facet of it. I think people were a little puzzled about why I would begin with somebody like Jarena Lee, right, when I could begin with Sojourner Truth. And so when I sat down at this round table, I said to these colleagues, you know, what I really want to know is why nobody really has taken seriously this part of All Bound Up Together. And they, you know, and so we kind of had a conversation about it, but I realized that it really bothered me. And Vanguard gave me, frankly, a chance to come back and to, you know, think through the evidence, think through my own powers of persuasion, to contextualize in very new ways that material, and maybe to speak to a different moment in which religious history, so-called religious history itself, is not so distant from social and political history in the way it very well may have been back in 2007 when that first book was published. So I do think that I've had more success this time around in persuading readers about church women. And this is a book where I do not apologize for taking a second bite at the apple, because there's a great deal here that is also brand new and fresh. But it is a testament to the way in which, right, our work actually always is unfolding and even progressing, right? Is that it's iterative, right? And we're never... Rarely are we making articles that arguments that come out of whole cloth, right? We're always talking to somebody, arguing with someone, building on someone. But on this point, you know, with the indispensable guidance of great historians like Evelyn Brooks Higginbotham and her Righteous Discontent, really doubling down on the notion that church women are really decisive in the story of Black women's politics. And I have to leave it, you know, to readers to determine whether or not I succeed this time around.
Interesting, thank you. I won't ask you about Henry Louis Gates' new book, but maybe we can.
Which, you know, by the way, I haven't read. I am in the PBS documentary, but I haven't had a chance yet to see the companion book.
So maybe we'll get you back to talk about that later. So Christina LaRocco says, thanks for a great talk, and has a question. Especially in light of the debates this summer about how violence against Black people has been turned into spectacle, Can you talk more about how you research and or write about violence against ordinary Black women who left fewer sources than did Bethune and others? How do you balance recognizing the realities of the terror they faced without reducing the entirety of their lives to this suffering?
Thank you for that. It was very important to me in this book to ensure that to the degree I could, and to every degree that I could, that I present in Vanguard the stories of women who I could draw as wholly formed people, and not just as illustrations or as examples. This is a technique I had really used and developed for my own self in a book I published in 2018 called Birthright Citizens, which is a look at Black activists in pre-Civil War Baltimore, and how they used the modest but critical possibilities of a local courthouse to make claims for rights, including claims for citizenship. And in those courthouse archives, I am encountering people who come and go, who appear and disappear from the record. So here I am learning to use the genealogist's archive, right? In order to recover small shards of lives and stitch them together, using courthouse records alongside newspapers, and in some instances having to draw sort of composite, right, scenes of people whose particulars just don't surface sufficiently for me to say more. So that technique is in Vanguard in some cases. And at the same time, I'll say that Vanguard was styled to be a book about a pantheon of women. It was coming in an anniversary year where I knew that too many folks would come to the table with a pantheon. And I don't have to rehearse that pantheon for you all, but it sounds like Stanton, and it sounds like Anthony, and it sounds like Kat, and it sounds like Paul. And so I believed that for this book, I needed women who really could clap back archivally, in addition to the substance of their lives. I needed women like Terrell, like Bethune, like Wells, and others who are lesser known, but nonetheless left a kind of robust record that would permit me to portray them in whole form. There is a different book, and I would say that my colleague at Wayne State University, Liette Gidlow, is at work on a version of that book in her very important work on Black women and voting rights at 1920 coming forward. Gidlow is looking at women who are appear in the record, much as the question suggests. And that is essential work, and work that I not only admire, I think is critical to the best understanding of Black women's political history. But Vanguard is not that book. It does a different kind of work. So I hope that to the degree that you encounter women who are new, women who are lesser known in the annals of historical writing, that I have managed to pull together a sufficiently robust set of shards that you can see them for their lives, in addition to how we might see them in this broader struggle for voting rights. I had wonderful students. I wrote this book alongside with my students. They over three semesters read and workshopped and conducted research into some of the women who ultimately make it into this book. And I hope I've acknowledged them well in the footnotes as well. And some of them were elusive, but I think important enough to let them stand in. And what a historian like me knows is that someone will come behind me. It's already happened, frankly. People write to you and say, here's a piece of the story of, you know, Mary Sharperson Young that you didn't discover. And I think that's a tribute, first and foremost, to the women who are the subjects of our work, but to the way our field works, right? Which is that we're always building on one another. So I would never be indifferent or blithe about the diligence, the due diligence that is my obligation as a, as the historian and as the author. But when you write a book that covers 200 years and a whole lot of terrain, you really hope someone will come behind you and dig in and develop even more fully some of the characters that make appearances in Vanguard.
Thank you so much. We're searching for some of those hidden voices in our current project, and it's,
you know, you are. Yeah.
It's hard to find.
It is. But I think we have to, you know, set out the markers, right? And some of the stories will elude us, you know, and others will not. And, you know, part of my writing about my family history was as an entreaty, right, to all of us who have family histories that we might misunderstand as somehow not being, right, appropriate, right, to the historical record. And I am not someone who believes that, and I'm someone who does work, right, that sort of argues implicitly to the contrary. And so I am meeting people, you know, who are descended from, who have collected their own shards about, and will continue to help us write and rewrite and write again these histories. We're in it for the long haul, right? I mean, that's why you all are the, you know, not just the keepers of the materials, but you are the stewards of the institutions, right? That have lives that extend beyond anybody's career.
We're definitely in it for the long haul. So Kat Antonelli asks, have you found any interesting patterns in attitude towards marriage or family among the activist Black women you studied? And did marital or family status seem to contribute in any way to the desire to be remembered or not?
Thank you. It is a fascinating question, and I can't say that I have generalities, but I think we see some fascinating examples of approaches to marriage and some fascinating men who, frankly, are married to women who are extraordinarily formidable in a time where is less evident than it might be today. So Mary Church Terrell, for example, her husband, Robert Terrell, is a judge in the District of Columbia, someone whose post on the bench there is threatened when Woodrow Wilson comes to Washington and the purge of Black men from the federal government begins. It's Terrell who goes behind the scenes in the halls of Congress to lobby to save his job, and does so because she's an Oberlin graduate, and there are Oberlin graduates in Congress who receive her and hear her. So there are these kinds of moments, right, where we see how marriages work for some of these women that I think, for me, just enlightened my thinking, right, about what marriage was in this period. I think most fascinating for me are the stories of daughters, which might be more conventional, but I think were stories I knew too little about. One example comes from a really serendipitous moment in the National Portrait Gallery, which some of you may remember had an exhibit up curated by historian Kate LeMay called Votes for Women. It was one of the early of the Washington exhibitions that that coincided with the suffrage anniversary. And in that, and this is a good, actually, this is a good archive story. So in that exhibition, Kate LeMay has borrowed one of Frances Ellen Watkins Harper's published works to display the book and to introduce Harper as a character, an early suffragist, the poet, novelist, and more. So it's in a case, and it's open to the portrait. Right, there's a portrait of Harper, a photographic portrait of Harper. And on the other side, in the facing page, is another portrait of a different woman. And what I realize in that moment, as I'm quizzing over who this second woman is, what I realize is that I've only ever seen this book in digital form. Right? I've never turned the pages. And so I've seen this portrait, I've used this portrait of Harper as an illustration, but I've never seen it in its natural state. And now I'm seeing it, and now I've got a question. And so Kate and I together write an article about Mary Harper, who was Frances Ellen Watkins Harper's daughter, beloved daughter, who herself was trained as an elocutionist, was a lecturer, and a companion to her mother. And this was a revelation to me, even as she was clearly dear, not only dear, she was an essential sort of facet, right, of Harper's life. I had missed it. And thank you. Yes, that's the article that somebody just pasted. I appreciate that, Celia. Thinking about mother to daughter and the ways in which absent the kind of political education, formal political education that might have happened in school or at college or university, many of the women in this story are training their daughters. You know, Mary Church Terrell takes her daughter Phyllis, you know, on the lecture circuit with her. What a political education that is. And what an investment that was in literal daughters and in figurative daughters, as in the example of Mary McLeod Bethune, who, you know, whose Daytona school, right, is raising up many, many generations of daughters. That to me was the most powerful story, is about how the lessons of politics, the skills and the imperatives of politics are being passed down across generations.
Wonderful, thank you. You actually preempted one question that I wanted to ask, which was about the difference between the digital and the original. So I think the classic example of how sometimes you really need to see the real thing, even though the digital is so convenient.
You really, really, really do. And, you know, so if I could just underscore that, because I'm working now with student researchers who have never known the real thing, coming into research as they have in the last year. And we've been so grateful, right, to every archivist, every librarian, every curator who has made materials available to us remotely, digitally, and otherwise. I would be remiss if I didn't say that first. But boy, these days, all I think of when I'm working with my students on one more giant PDF document is, oh, we should be sitting together at a table somewhere, you know, and going through this material and trying to teach them, right, that part of the craft is a real, you know, as you all know, has just been a real challenge.
Truly. We'll get back there.
We will.
I have one late breaking question, and then I think we'll wrap up. We so appreciate your thoughtful answers. Have you used any small archives or private archives that might be in private hands, collections that aren't generally accessible?
So I'll go back to the years when I was working on All Bound Up Together, and that material, some of it is still in Vanguard. I was interested very much in church history, AME church, AME Zion history, very little of which, and now I'm thinking especially about conference minutes, very little of which was anywhere in the places I first looked for it. And then I got an invitation, or maybe I wrangled an invitation, that's probably more like it, from Dr. Dennis Dickerson, who in those years was the bibliographer of the AME Church and had his headquarters in Nashville in Tennessee. He's on the faculty at Vanderbilt. And he invited me in, and I sat at a little round cafe table in his office and worked my way through the 19th century pamphlets that were collected on his bookshelf in his office. And for all I know, still sit there until today. And then he sort of emboldened me, and I wound up in North Carolina at Salisbury University, which is the AME Church University, which had its own archive. I took the train down, you know, and got off in Rocky Mount. I don't know, but I wound up there, or maybe Greensboro, and I got off, and I went up in Salisbury. No, the train actually stops in Salisbury. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it did. And I remember that because when I was leaving, I almost missed it. There was the privately held collection of the church, including those kinds of early pamphlets. And I was the only person there. And they were so gracious. And I ate in the cafeteria. You know these stories. They're so wonderful. And the success day, the day when I knew I had succeeded, is when the archivist said to me, "Oh, just go help yourself." And I thought, yes, I've arrived. And I've never forgotten it. And those materials were indispensable. Those materials exist, as best I know, nowhere else. Nowhere else.
Well, thank you. We all aspire to find those hidden caches of wonderful material. And I'm not seeing any more questions. I could talk with you forever, but
I feel the same. Thank you all so much.
We are so grateful that you were able to join us tonight and really serve as a highlight, the highlight of our 2-day symposium. So thank you so much. And we'll all go out and buy Vanguard, I think, and read it with great enthusiasm.
Or just borrow it from your library. I believe in that too. Thank you all so much. It's really been a privilege to be with you. I thank you for all the thoughtfulness and care. I really do.
Take care.
I think.